Welcome, Messiah. Please stand as we start our first song, One of These Days.
One of these days I'm gonna fly over the mountains. One of these days I'm gonna ride on a silver lining. One of these days I'm gonna witness all I've been missing. One of these days. One of these days I'm gonna do all the things that I've never done. I'm gonna finish all the races that I've run but I've never won. I'm gonna see a million faces, recognize everyone. One of these days. One of these days I'm gonna see the hand that took the nails from me. One of these days I'm gonna hold the key to the mansion built for me. One of these
here today. Thank you for taking all of the saints that we have loved in our lives. Thank you for taking away their pain and for seeing them face to face. While we wait for our time, please help us to handle our pain and our sorrows and all of the things that are difficult, and help us see your face in those around us and share your love with them. In your name we pray. Amen.
For here
this All Saints Day. Today is a special day at Messiah. We will be having some rituals remembering those who have passed from our community in this year, and we'll light candles to honor each of them. You will also have an opportunity, if you like, when you come up to communion, if you would like to light a candle of your own and pray for loved ones that have gone in your life, please feel free to do that. We have one more song, I'll Fly Away, so join us.
When this love
the Lord be with you all. Please rise and share the peace with each other.
I'm just really loud. Oh, now I'm on. And then the other thing is I want to do announcements too, because it's kind of an ending that's a little dramatic. And so rather than introduce that with announcements, and Pastor Liz wrote down the announcements for me because she's doing it traditional. So I better look at them. One, we're in a harvest month in November. So a couple things are going on. One, we are emphasizing food drives, collecting food. Our Cub Scouts, we're asking them to collect food. Our preschool is collecting food, and the church is collecting food. And we're going to share all this food with Heart Food Pantry and with LSS, to Luther Social Services, their food pantries. And so you'll receive some Heart Food Pantry bags when you leave, I believe. You'll receive some bags. I believe they're Heart Food Pantry bags. I'm not quite sure about that second one. And Howard and Alex will pass those out for you, so grab those as you leave. Second thing is we're having a big harvest festival to support Heart Food Pantry. And there isn't another church in our community that is having a fundraiser this year for Heart. So this fundraiser is really important. So come, enjoy. It is a good fundraiser because you get like feted and you get... We have a 70 kids children's choir that's going to be here. 70 kids, that's a lot. And they travel around the world. So they're like good, right? So that'll be fun. And then we have we simplified the meal. We just made it something good and homey. We got chicken and noodles and mashed potatoes and for the meal. We have takeout that you can get. But really where we make all of our money is a woman named Karen Lytle has gathered $7,000 of silent auction stuff. So bid on all the gift cards that she has and everything else. And encourage your neighbors and friends to come and bid on all that too. Because that is, hopefully we'll make $7,000. So that would be wonderful for Heart Food Pantry. So that's happening next week. You can buy tickets for that as you're leaving today. And the youth stayed overnight last night. I remember this announcement. The youth stayed overnight last night, and they did things. They ran through the place and broke all sorts of stuff, and it's going to cost us all sorts of money. But beyond that, they also gathered. They also made shut-in bags, and they're asking you people to take them and deliver them. So if you could look and grab one of the shut-in bags, if you know any of those people, and take them. And deliver them. There's a sheet that my notes say that you're supposed to take with the directions on how to get there. I'm not quite sure what that means, but But you can ask Pastor Liz. She'll be floating around. She's teaching Sunday school downstairs this morning. And then the final thing is good news. We raised $174,000 with the capital campaign last week. So that is news worth of clapping. And we're hoping that number grows even. For those people who miss Sunday or that they will commit over the next few weeks, and we'll start with whatever money we don't spend. We will start a capital fund so that we'll be in a better position the next time we get here and need stuff. There you go. Let's continue with worship. Oh, yeah. Jane just reminded me, kids should be leaving. Kids should be leaving. So follow Betsy, she's out there. Go that way, Keegan. The other way. There she is. Thanks, Jane.
No problem. A reading from the book of Revelation. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also, he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life." The word of the Lord. Please stand for the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to John. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." The Gospel of the Lord.
And Mary said, "Lazarus, come out." Mary wept at the tomb that day. Even though they were wealthy, they could pay professional mourners, which is what wealthy people did back then, to weep at the tomb. No one wept as hard as Mary did at the tomb. understand me, her brother drove her crazy like brothers drive you crazy. He was into her stuff when she was a kid, and now that he was an adult, he had his nose in her business every bit as much. He had opinions about how she raised her kids, about her husband and what he should be doing, about how often she visited her mother, even what dress she should wear or what tunic she should wear to her sister's wedding. Lazarus was all over her stuff. But she also treasured that concern that he had for her. And she knew that Lazarus loved her possibly more than anyone else. And with his death, that love seemed like it was gone too. Gone. And that made her weep. And as she wept, she just wished he wasn't gone. That he could come out. Lazarus, come out. We've got a lot of candles here this week, this year. And we had a lot of candles last year. And each one of those pillars of wax represents somebody that we knew well, that we hoped to know well. And there's people that have come today. Marilyn's family's here, I see. And others who are just simply part of our congregation that are here. Ruth Ann's there. Who are grieving this pillars today. And I was thinking about grief. That, you know, grief is a general sense of just feeling, yeah, right? But it's also a very specific thing. Right? We grieve in a very, very specific things that we've missed. Like, I no longer have this good friend to call any longer who was so wise and gave me such good counsel. I miss that they made me laugh when they said something terribly inappropriate that I wouldn't have ever said in public, but they always said in public, right? Or I simply miss someone who accepted me. Because I can be pretty unacceptable sometimes. Or I miss this person who was able to forgive me after I really, really did something that I shouldn't have been forgiven for. I mean, we miss very specific things about people. And as we grieve and as we miss these things, we join with Mary, right? Because there will never be another Daryl for Ruth Ann, or another Marilyn for Amy. And we just wish time could turn back. And we stand at the tomb and we say, Lazarus, come out. And Martha said, Lazarus, come out. Don't get me wrong. Martha believed, right? She believed in the resurrection. She believed that she was going to see Lazarus again. She believed in Jesus. She just didn't do religious stuff. She lived religious stuff. She prayed the Psalms. She celebrated all the festivals, every single one of them, and there's a lot of them. She sacrificed the right amount of things. She went to synagogue. She was the one who told Lazarus that she was sure he was the Messiah. Lazarus had come, she served him a meal, and then she stayed in the next room and she heard him teach the men. And she was moved by his teaching. She knew Jairus, whose beautiful daughter, it was said, Jesus brought back to life. Veronica was her cousin who she touched the back cloak of. Jesus and her menstrual flow stopped. Veronica told her this. And who hadn't given money to the beggar, blind Bartimaeus, who now could see better than Martha because of Jesus? She could attest to these miracles. She had heard the teachings. She could attest to the miracles. She knew Jesus was sent from God. And even more, she knew that Jesus was of God some way. But now he tells her that he is even more powerful than death, and I'm sorry. I can smell this tomb. Death stinks, Jesus. And you want me to open it up? Better to let sleeping dogs lie. Lazarus, come out. I'm guessing that almost everybody in here believes in God, believes in a God of love that loves us so much that he's longed for us to be back in relationship, and that's what Jesus is about, to draw us back into that relationship. Believes in a resurrection and in a heaven and seeing people again. I'm guessing that nearly everybody in this room believes that on some level. But the way faith works, right, is that sometimes we really, 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 really believe. And then other times we sort of believe. And then other times we don't want any part of it at all. Right? Where we're not having it. For me, those times happen when the world seems especially screwed up, which seems like all the time. You know, where people are just mean and petty, and I don't understand it. Senseless violence. I just don't get it. I mean, if there is a God, why is all this junk going around? Sometimes I go there. And then other times it's around just the power and the finality of death. And the randomness, the bad luckedness of death, right? Why this person? Why that time? Why that painfulness of it? And the aloneness of it, too. Because our grief is specific to us. And you know all the things, right? that Jesus conquers death, and you know that up here, but boy, your heart just doesn't feel it. And you stand at that tomb, and death stinks. And what you know comes out. Lazarus, come out. Like there's nothing beyond this. And Jesus said, Lazarus, come out. Jesus wept that day, right? That's what scripture tells us. And he wept that day not only because he missed Lazarus, his friend, as the crowd thought he was weeping. He wept that day not only because Mary's tears were so plentiful that surely they were contagious. He wept that day because everyone he loved was weeping that day. And when people who Jesus loves weep, Jesus weeps. When you weep, our God weeps. And Jesus wept in solidarity to the pain that those people were feeling because of the loss of their brother, their friend, their family member, Lazarus. Jesus wept that day, and then do you know what he did? He got angry. It says greatly disturbed. The Greek word is angry. He got angry. He got angry because the power of death to crush and hurt people that he loved. He got angry that death was felt victorious. And he knew that wasn't the end. He got angry because death was hurting people that he loved. And when Jesus got angry, he said, not today. Death is not going to win this day. He got angry and he stood at that tomb and he said, I don't care if you do stink, death. I am stronger than you. And I'm declaring victory today over death. He got angry and he yelled at that tomb, Lazarus, come out. And Lazarus was resuscitated, we say. He wasn't resurrected. Poor Lazarus had to die again. But what we believe, when Lazarus was, that Lazarus in the resurrection lies in the bosom of Jesus today. Jesus who wept for him. Jesus who wept for his family. Jesus who got angry at the power of death in this world. Jesus who broke that power of death and declared victory. And we believe that Lazarus lies in the bosom of Jesus, just as we believe that Karl lies at the bosom of Jesus, that Marilyn lies at the bosom of Jesus, that Hallie lies at the bosom of Jesus, that Daryl lies at the bosom of Jesus. That death will not be the last word. That is the heart of our faith. We are death and resurrection people. And when Lazarus was resuscitated, he got up and he served our Lord. Death has a power over us. It is a foe. It is a tough enemy, for sure. Not just the devastation of losing someone you love, but the death of other things in your life, the death of a job that gave you security, the death of a relationship, even though it wasn't the greatest relationship, it was someone to spend a Saturday afternoon with. We grieve things throughout the midst of our lives, whether they are people, whether they're relationships, whether they're lost objects. And we are death and resurrection people. Lazarus got up and he served our Lord. We are called in the midst of the death that we experience to live. And if you can't live, then to surround your people, surround yourself with people who can for you. If you can't believe today, and often we can't, then surround yourself with people whose faith will be strong enough for you to hold you and encourage you, like you'll be called to hold and encourage someone else so that they can live the abundant life of serving the Lord. Because our Lord hates death and conquered it. And he said, come out. Our Lord wanted abundant life for you. And he said, come out. Our Lord has conquered death once and for all. The victory is won. And our abundant life starts today. And Jesus said, come out. Amen. Three times.
Please join me.
Remember.
trust in the conquering of death that Jesus accomplished in his death and resurrection. Help us hold on to that in the midst of our grief. Help us hold on to that and lift it up for others in the midst of their grief. Help us trust that those we miss are in your very bosom right now, Lord. We pray for the brokenness of this world, that people be healed and love again. We pray for all those families grieving in Pittsburgh after this last mass shooting at a house of prayer. And we pray for those who are in fear today in their houses of prayer, that they may know that your presence is near. And we pray for all those who are hurting this morning from physical pain or grief or financial stress or anger. We pray for those that we name aloud now. And let us sing.
Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.
Life, remember those who have gone before us and have joined the saints victorious. We name those that our church has served and been served by. Mary Lou Fritz. Marilyn Potter. Harold Kaler. Kathleen Sackett. Lane Sampson. Doris Gellner. Daryl Sickles. Darlene Damros. Carl Schweikert. Carolyn March. Harlan Soppy. Janet Jones. Hallie Susan Schlett. Mighty Lord, by the witness of your saints, show us the hope and strengthen us in these days so that we may delight and grab the abundant life that you promise. The salvation that we covet was promised by Jesus, who we trust with our lives, the Word made flesh, who even after dying and ascending to the heavens, remembered us with his Spirit and promised to be with us today in this bread and in this wine. For in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it for all to eat, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup and poured it for his disciples, gave it to them to drink after blessing it and saying, "This cup is a sign of the new covenant shed in my blood for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for remembrance of me. For as often as we eat this bread and drink this wine, we proclaim the very mystery of faith, that Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. With this bread and cup, we remember that the Word dwells among us. We remember our new birth in his death and now our resurrection in his life. And we are strengthened for the journey ahead and the abundant life that we have been promised. With all the saints in every time and every place, we gather around this meal to eat the very presence of our Lord, who the saints luxuriate in now. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our assistants will come out and they will commune. And then we'll invite you forward to share this communion. And if you'd like to light a candle in memory of someone who you grieve, has been lost to you days ago or years ago. And for our visitors today, please know that this is Christ's meal. This is an open table. You are a child of God, and you are invited to come and eat with us this morning. We believe that God is truly present here and wants to be present in you. The body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Matt, please.
Cuando Él me ama,
Let us pray. Holy God, we trust the blessing that each one of these saints have already received. And for us on our journey here, walk with us now so that we may enjoy the abundant life that they are enjoying in heaven too. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you God's peace. Amen. Please rise and sing.
Serve the Lord.